Throughout this course, we will encounter a variety of technologies and tools that enable designers, artists, developers, and data scientists to express their views and communicate their insights with the world at large. And while we will try to expose you to what we think are the most relevant tools to help you create data visualizations, there are far too many technologies out there to cover them all. However, you may encounter them, or at least people who use them, so it is a good idea to have some sense of what is there. At the bottom of this spectrum are low-level graphics formats and specifications. These are some of the most efficient, performant, and flexible of your options when choosing to create a visualization, but are very low level and have significant overhead not only to learn, but to develop in. Think of these as the assembly language of visualizations. While these technologies are very flexible in what you can do, they force you to specify what you want done in terms of pixels and lines. Or rather, place a point at X, Y, and create a path to point W, Z. This is much like if you are instructing a painter or robot how to draw. As you go up the spectrum to higher level languages and libraries, it becomes much easier and faster to develop your graphics, though the tool you may use may be slightly less flexible than raw HTML5 canvas, WebGL, or SVG. A hop, skip, and a jump up, we have our beloved D3.js. We will get more into the specifics of D3 in just a second, but it is a data visualization library built atop open web standards. It is implemented in JavaScript and allows for seamless binding of data to HTML and SVG elements, or actually anything on a web page, really. Since you can style HTML and SVG with CSS, CSS works very naturally with the whole stack of technologies that D3.js is built atop. D3, contrary to what most people may think, is actually pretty low of an abstraction. If we were continuing our analogy of programming languages and what they're built atop, I would say that D3, in the spectrum of visualization technologies, is actually at a similar level to where C or C++ is in the whole spectrum of programming languages. And just like people use C and C++ to build operating systems, programs, and compilers for other languages, D3 really shines when you use it to build higher level abstractions and libraries on top of it. And this brings us to the suite of D3.js libraries. This layer represents the plethora of high level libraries built atop the building blocks of D3. While there are far too many libraries to list or even fit on the screen that are built atop D3, three of the most common, or ones that we would mention in this class, are Rickshaw, dimple.js, and NVD3. People often like to think of D3.js as data visualization library Legos. You can very easily compose D3.js components to build higher level abstractions and libraries on top of it. While it might seem very daunting to navigate the space of every library built on top of D3, they usually fall into one of two categories. They are either high-level charting libraries like NVD3 and dimple.js, or they are tailored to a specific type of data, like Rickshaw. Rickshaw was built to most effectively and easily visualize time series and real-time streaming data. In this same vein of visualizing a specific type of data are also geographic libraries to help plot data on maps and add interaction to maps. We will use dimple.js in this class in the later lessons and really experience the power of using a higher level abstraction than straight D3. And again, going back to our spectrum of programming languages, if WebGL, Canvas, and SVG are analogous to assembly language, D3 is analogous to C and C++, I would say the higher level libraries built atop of D3 are similar in abstraction level to something like Python or Ruby. Python and Ruby are fairly high level languages. They're interpreted. You don't have to deal with memory collection. And many times they are implemented in C or C++. And just like these higher level languages are implemented in a lower level language, NVD3, dimple.js, and rickshaw can be thought of as implemented in or on top of D3.js. At the very top of the spectrum are libraries that have graphical interfaces for creating visualizations such as RAW or Chartio. RAW is an open source library built on top of D3 that allows you to very easily and quickly build predefined charts. Chartio is a web-based product similar to Tableau that allows you to very quickly and easily explore your data to build dashboards and charts, hence the name Chartio. Since these libraries are so high up on the spectrum, they have very limited flexibility and can usually only produce a set of predefined charts. The upside to having a set number of predefined charts is that it creates those almost effortlessly and quite seamlessly. Think of these as the Excel of data visualization libraries. They are incredibly useful for about 90 or 95% of the use cases you most likely will encounter, and they make those 95% of cases quite effortless if their charts happen to match what you're looking for. But if you stray from this path of predefined charts, it may be cumbersome, if not impossible, to customize them. If none of my silly analogy to computer programming languages made any sense, do not worry. You'll not need to know any of this for the class. Hopefully, however, it helped some folks get a better sense of where each of these technologies stands on the spectrum of abstraction and visualization. I sometimes like to think of these technologies existing within a pyramid of abstraction. Think of the width of the level of the pyramid representing how flexible each of the technologies at that level are, and the height up the pyramid as how easy it makes it to create visualizations and how much developer productivity they enable. At the bottom of the pyramid are technologies that have quite a lot of flexibility and offer a lot of gains in performance and efficiency, but may be very difficult to use and slow to develop in. At the other end of the spectrum, and at the top of the pyramid, you have technologies like RAW and Chartio, which are very easy to use, allow you to develop visualizations very quickly and iterate on those visualizations, but may be much less flexible than something like WebGL or D3. One thing you always have to consider as a developer, especially if you're working on a data science project, where the entire scope of the project is much larger than just the visualization portion, is the trade-off between developer productivity and efficiency of your solution. Due to recent trends in the performance improvements in the browser and of all technologies involved, and also in the abstractions created by higher level libraries, developers are quite fortunate and get something of the best of both worlds between being very productive and having quite flexible and efficient libraries. Because of this, you can have your cake and eat it too, or rather, code in a high level library and still get decent performance and flexibility. And while each of the many data visualization libraries out there have their strengths and weaknesses, in this class, we will focus on the particular JavaScript library, D3.